I was glad when we said, let us go into the house of the Lord. It is a beautiful Lord's Day, and we can excite at being at the presence of our Lord. I want to tell you this morning, we are worshiping in the presence of a superstar. Where did Tay go? Boy, he snuck out. He knew I was going to throw him out. Hey, I was informed that Tay finished fourth in the region yesterday in his classification in wrestling, and he is headed to semi-state. So, yeah. So, when you see Tay today, be sure to pat him on the back. Not too hard, because you don't want him to think it's a wrestling move. That might be dangerous, right? Oh, isn't it fun to be church? This morning we're in for a special treat. Miss Lisa Taylor is going to serve as our worship leader this morning, and we're so thankful for her willingness to serve the Lord with us, and we're excited for the gifts that she brings. Thank you for your willingness to serve. God bless you. So enjoy that. Just a few announcements. Do not forget, immediately following morning worship this morning, ministry teams will meet, Christian Ed, Member Care, Worship. What else am I missing? Those committees will be meeting today. Want to encourage you to be a part of the work of the church. And next Sunday, please mark your calendar, be faithful to be here. Matt and Heather Wallace will be here to lead us in our worship service and to share with us their ministry in Myanmar. You look like you're eager to say something, so I'm going to get out of your way.
I've always got something to say. I'm just waiting patiently. Sign-up sheet for Children's Church is in the hallway, and I'm also going to try something new. If you are not familiar with it, it's okay, but I'm going to send out an email with a sign-up genius in it to where you can just click on it and automatically sign up for what Sunday you want, because sometimes we forget when we're in here. So I'm going to do both. I'm going to create an email that will be sent out to you, plus we've got the sheet. If you do not know how to operate Sign-Up Genius, that's okay. Just shoot me a text, call me, email me, whatever, and say, sign me up for this Sunday, and I'll get you taken care of. Second, yes, we are in February, but VBS will be here before we know it. So I am in preparations for that. If you have a niche that you want to do something, whether it be decorating, helping in the kitchen, working with a class, if you don't want to teach a class but you want to help with one, let me know, because I'm getting ready to start making preparations for the decorating team, as well as the teachers, kitchen help, all of it. So if you would like to help somewhere and you just don't care where, I can get that taken care of too. So just be thinking, because I do need to start getting volunteers for the different areas. And so I think that's it for today, at least.
Thank you. Thank you. Other announcements? If not, brothers and sisters, we've gathered because our Lord is worthy of praise. Let us block out the distractions. Let us prepare our hearts, prepare our minds. And together, let us worship a risen Lord. Let us worship God.
Aren't you thankful for God's amazing grace?
Yes.
You ever just contemplate that, what it's like that somebody stood in your place and took the punishment for your sin, for our sin? It is amazing. you would stand. Join with me. Was blind, but now I see. Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace
Take your bulletin or watch the screen, and let us join together as we confess that which we believe, praying in unison the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into the dead, and on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Is it my turn?
It's your turn.
Now, I'm telling you now, this is our turn. You listen now. I got treats. Good morning. Right. Oh. Look, I'm luring you in. Alright, you're not this one. Alright, good morning. I am so excited. You know, Miss Tammy and I, we taught kindergarten forever. I won't say ever, never, never. But anyway, Miss Tammy, how do you love every holiday? Where is she? Okay. Yeah, somebody said, I hate Grandpa's Day. And I said, I love it. You name it, I love it. Okay. And what holiday are we getting ready to have? Yes. Yes, Valentine's Day. Now, I don't know why I'm that excited. I'm sure my seven grandsons won't think of me. They might. But that's okay. But you know what? I was so excited. I tried to find my picture when I went to Sunday school. And I went out in the garage, and I couldn't find it. But I went to Sunday school and to church, and my favorite verse in the Bible is, for God so loved the world, can you say it with me? For God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And I was so excited. Last Sunday, I looked, and they had little details to put on there. And I thought, I loved it. And my favorite hymn was Love Lifted Me. And I can still remember that, how old I was. But I am so excited that we are doing John 3:16. And, you know, with it being Valentine's Day, I found this. It says, be kind, be polite, be helpful, be responsible, and be considerate. Now, what does considerate mean? If you are considerate, now I know, are you considerate? Yes, I knew that you would know. Could you be my grandson? Sometimes, now I will have to say, I watched mine play ball yesterday, and Owen said, Graham, he hugged me, he said, thanks for coming. And I thought, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. He hugged me. And I know he loves me, but you know, I know how guys are. So anyhow, I want you to think of that. And if you are considerate, you put your needs, other people's needs, before yours. Now that's hard to do. I have a 97-year-old mother, and sometimes I have to really work hard to be considerate. And so said, now, you know that how to wash clothes. And I'll say, Mother, I'm 65 years old. I know how to do laundry. But anyhow, so I have to vote on this one myself. So let's all see if we can be considerate of others. Now, I need you to do something for me. I want you to look at everybody in the church. Now, we are going to do John 3:16. And we love everybody in our church, don't we? Yeah. All right, let's stand up. Now, look what I want you to do. I have these for you, but I want you, now I know because of COVID that maybe we shouldn't hug, but if I want you to go to all the people, now not just grandma, grandpa, and uncle, I want you to find somebody, you can't do it unless you hug and give somebody a kiss and tell them, I love you. Now, can you do that? Yeah? Who can do that? All right, take two or three. All right.
I said happy Valentine's Day to my mom and
to my mother. Look, don't forget them. Take two or three. I want you to go to someone in church. Look, and say, I love you.
Once you do this, you get one of those, okay?
Yeah.
Let's take one.
You're going to take one?
You got to take one to Paul, one to Mama.
All right, now don't forget. All right, I'm going to be the love police. All right. Oh, look, this guy, he's not. All right. Don't forget. Did anybody forget anybody? You did everybody? Over here? Over there? Back there? Now don't, hey, they're going to be full of love. And high on chocolate. All right. Now, all right, who did not get a, look, that's there. And Nate, oh my gosh, Nate, you are in trouble. And you are my main man. All right, now, after you do it, let's come back and let's have a prayer. And I want everybody to do John 3:16. All right, ready? Come on, hurry. All right, you ready? All right. Let's run the whole church. 1, 2, 3. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. All right. If there's not enough, I've got these letters. That's the best part of being a grandma. You can just shoot them up and send them home. All right, hurry up.
Wait, can I get that?
Yeah. All right, there's some on the floor. All right, you want one?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, let's stand and wrap our hearts and our arms around Jesus. and tell him how much we love him through this song. If I miss the cue this time, you people help me.
There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. Sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father had in store.
Jesus. Do you love Jesus this morning? How many are aware of what is going on right now at Asbury College Seminary? If you have not heard the news, let me share it with you. Can I do that? Sometime Wednesday in chapel, revival broke out. And at last report, those students have not left chapel as of last night. Revival is breaking out all through the state of Kentucky. People are now beginning to migrate up to Asbury to join in the revival and the praising of our God. I'm understanding there are conversions, there are healings, there is testimonies, there is witnessing, there is a falling out of the presence of our Lord unlike anything we have seen in probably 3 decades. Now, for all of you who believe in the power of prayer, how long have you been praying for revival? You know, I think maybe I've been praying selfishly, David, because I've been saying, let there be a revival, and can it begin in me, and can it begin right here? And I think God picked Asbury. But can't we join the celebration? Can't we get excited for Jesus? Can't we share our testimonies? Can't we literally love one another with the presence of Jesus Christ? We don't have to be physically present in Asbury to join that revival and celebrate our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning, my simple prayer, let us join the revival that our Lord has already started. Will you join me in prayer? Father, this morning, we just get so excited when we see the movement of your Holy Spirit, and we begin to get a glimpse of how real and how powerful and how great is our God. And Father, we confess, we look into our world and sometimes we get so consumed with everything that's going on around us, and we feel so overwhelmed that we don't realize that you can use a few Bible-believing Christians and you can sprinkle them around and you can call them to a purpose that we can literally be salt and light into this world, that transformation would begin to take place and that your glory would be revealed and your kingdom would prosper. Somehow, Lord, as Christians in our present world, we've kind of lost direction of what the true gospel is all about. We confess, Lord, sometimes we get self-focused and we are more concerned about what you can do for me and in my life than we are concerned about the magnitude of what you've already done and the glories and the privileges of being able to share you with others. Father, we praise you for what is happening. We pray, Lord, for the courage to participate, and we pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to continue to stir, drawing, well, this community, these families, expand it out, Lord. And may our only prayer be that you would be glorified, that your kingdom would receive the growth for the glory of the one who died, that we might live, for the one who rose again to show us the way, for the one who is seated on the right hand of the Father and holds all authority, we pray. Amen and amen.
Thank you. us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we bring these tithes and offerings to your throne, that may they build your kingdom. May they bless the people that are out there that are lost, and just be with our lost, be with our ones on our prayer list, be the ones at Asbury. Just do what you do best, God. We ask you in these things in your Lord Jesus' name. Amen.
So praise the Lord, praise Jesus. There's a Savior. That's what it's all about. There is a Savior. What joy is expressed. His eyes are mercy. His word. A memory that binds you. Is there some pain that you've carried far too long? Well, strengthen your heart for this good.
Lisa sung it. Just do what you do best. What does Jesus Christ do best? Seek and save the lost. Thank you. What a powerful testimony and song this morning. We are so blessed. This morning, I'm going to invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew. If you will return to the 5th chapter, we will resume where we left off before we were interrupted for denominational Sunday. Okay? We're going to go back to the 5th chapter of Matthew. We will begin with verse 13 and conclude with verse 16. For those who are able, as you find your passage, I invite you to stand in reverence to the Holy Word of God. Matthew chapter 5, beginning with verse 13, Jesus said, anybody got their Bible in red? Right? The red letters. Jesus said, you, not that person behind you, you are the salt of the earth. If the salt has lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do people light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Will you join me as we ask the Lord's blessing upon the written word of God? Father, this is your word. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the words of your Son, but we thank you even more for your Son. And in this moment, Lord, we thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit that lifts words off the page, gives proclamation and definition to all that you intend for us to hear, and for planting those very words in our hearts, transforming us from who we are and what we are into everything you've called us to be. Lord, have your way in us. Move us from where we are to where you would have us be. All for your glory and the glory of your Son, Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. I want to begin this morning by expressing appreciation to Reverend Becky Zarte for her help both in the preparation as well as the presentation of last week's birthday celebration to the Cumberland Presbyterian Church. Didn't she do a wonderful job? Come on, yeah, absolutely. I won't embarrass her and make her stand up and take a bow, but I had so much fun working with you both in the preparation and in the presentation, and I truly believe we walked out of here last Sunday renewed with an understanding of who we are as a people called Cumberland Presbyterian. Sometimes we need to pause and remember our heritage. But now, in the aftermath of that celebration, we're faced with the challenge of reconnecting the text to our Sunday prior. What I'm saying, folks, is I do not believe that we can fully understand what Jesus is trying to get us to hear this morning unless we reconnect it to the first 12 verses of the fifth chapter. Now, you might remember in those first 12 verses, 9 times Jesus said, "Blessed are." And we looked at those Beatitudes, and what we discovered was something very much akin to a treasure map. Step-by-step directions growing us from spiritual infancy into spiritual maturity. Remember, Jesus became what we are in order that we might become what he is. Jesus expects a total transformation in every single converted heart. In this way, the Beatitudes become our map on our road to becoming. That was lesson number one. Now, lesson number two, that's our text for the morning. Think about it. If an authentic encounter with the risen Christ is intended to transform who we are, would it not then be a reasonable expectation for those who are in Christ, for those of us who are on the road to becoming, if those of us who are striving to be Christ-like, would it not be a reasonable expectation for us then to project a transforming influence into the world in which we live? Jesus thinks so. At least that's what he said. Watch the text. I want you to see this. Immediately following the Beatitudes, Jesus turns the focus from those who are being transformed into what we're to do with what has been transformed, right? Jesus looks at us and he says, "You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world." Salt has an effect on everything in which it's applied. We put salt on icy sidewalks, on frozen winter roads to melt the ice away. We put salt, my wife loves salt on her food. We put salt on our food. Why? Because it adds a little extra zest, a little extra flavor. Throughout history, however, I was reminded in Sunday school class this morning how the old farmers would kill the hog and we'd hang the meat up in the smokehouse after the salt had been applied to preserve the meat so it would be good, some farmers would say, forever. In this way, it fought against bacteria. It fought against premature decay. And now, in the same way, Jesus now charges all who follow him with the responsibility then of adding his love, his warmth to an otherwise cold and uncaring world, to add a little extra zest, a little extra flavor. But most of all, don't miss this, God fully intends, God has entrusted you to help preserve the moral fabric of his creation. Writing that line this week, I admit I had a private chuckle with God. I couldn't help it. I got this vision. Tim says he's a visionary. He sees things. I got this vision of God taking a God-sized salt shaker, filling it full of real Bible-believing Christians, and then just start sprinkling them out all over Owensboro. Some of you are not laughing. See, the point is, when we understand all the moral influences we face, God truly expects you and I to make a difference. God actually expects you and I as his children, and individually, but then collectively as church. We are a unified body. So collectively as church, God actually expects you and I to make a difference in the world in which we live. When we as the people of God begin to take seriously this divine charge of being salt, once again, we'll start taking a moral stand for God and the things of God. By word and by example, we will be careful to live out God's love, striving to live in divine obedience. When we understand the magnitude of God's love and the price of our salvation, how is it possible that we continue to go through this world unconcerned with the spiritual health of those around us? We sing, "Oh, how I love Jesus." But do we love Jesus enough to share him with someone else? Oh, now, preacher, you're starting to cross that line, aren't you? Jesus said, I want you to see this. This is powerful. Jesus said, if the salt has lost his savor. And I just got to ask, how many think Jesus is talking about flavor as in the salt somehow lost its saltiness? It's okay. That's what I thought too. That's what I have read all. I mean, that's what I have read. That's what I have heard all my life. But newsflash, that ain't what he's talking about. First, let me point out the use of a personal pronoun. His Savior. Jesus is speaking of a living, breathing organism. Jesus is speaking of a person or even the church as a whole, as in the salt has lost his Savior. Next, the Greek word implied here is moreno, literally wanting or lacking in spirit. So the question is, when a Christian, church, we're going to get our toes stepped on here, okay? When a Christian or when the church as a whole becomes wanting or lacking in the Spirit of God, what are we good for? Jesus said nothing but to be trodden under the foot of men. In other words, when we become wanting or lacking in spirit, either individually or collectively as church, our testimony or the effects of our testimony become ignored by the world, labeled as hypocrisy, and trampled under by the feet of others. Without the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, alive and active, our testimony is worthless. That's what he's saying. The second metaphor Jesus uses reminds us we are the light of the world. I must confess, every time I read that passage of Scripture, my mind flashes back and I'm back in VBS and I've got my little candle. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Hide it under a bushel? No! Won't let Satan it out? No! Right? And I want to say this morning, that training served us very well as infant Christians. Somebody say amen. Right? But I want to say this morning as your pastor, it lacks an element of growth necessary for the maturing Christian. There's something more here that we need to hear. Jesus did not come into this world to serve as a righteous candle in the midst of a moral power failure. The essence of the Epiphany season reminds us Jesus is that true light. Jesus came to show us the Father. Through the light of Christ, we see a God of love, a God holy, righteous, a God full of mercy. Through the light of Christ, we see the God of our salvation and the God of new beginnings and second chances. The acolytes could go on and on and on. But frankly, what I want to suggest this morning is lost in the familiarity of American Christendom, I think, is that Jesus, we've lost the magnitude and the grandeur of all Jesus is. John the Revelator gives us a glimpse of the magnitude of what it means when we say Jesus Christ is the true light. And he writes in the coming kingdom, stating that there is no need for the sun, for the glory of God provided the light. And here's the punchline: and the Lamb is that light. Did you catch it? And I who is it, Louis Giglio, that talks about Christ speaks, but stars appear? And John the Revelator ups him. He says, you know what? Jesus is brighter than anything he spoke into creation. That's our Jesus. That's the magnitude of the true light John speaks of as he writes, Jesus came into this world as the light of men. Yet this morning, here's what I want you to see. Verse 15, Jesus just turns that whole thing around for us, and Jesus challenges you and I to be that light into the world. Now, you got to put them both back together. Jesus came as our light. Jesus came to show us the way to the Father. And then, for all who see the Father, we are then to be the light into the world, showing others the way to Jesus. That's what he's talking about. And I get it. It's hard. Gosh, it's hard. Especially when we acknowledge Jesus didn't call us to be a little light. He expects you to be bright. He expects you to be glowing. He expects you to be easily seen. Notice the two metaphoric images. Jesus says, a city on a hill cannot be hid, neither do we light a candle only to attempt to hide the light. That's two distinct examples. It's two distinct images, neither of which suggests that our lights are going to be small and insignificant. Maybe the better comparison might be thinking of the moon, which reflects the light of the sun. And you've been out on a full moon night when the moon is big and bright. Man, it's easy to see, isn't it? When we reflect the brilliance of God's divine light, our lives will be so bright they illuminate our homes, even out into the world. And this way, I want you to understand the two analogies speak to us both individually as Christians and then collectively as a unified church when we come together. Think of it this way. When we light a candle, or in our case, you walk in the room, you turn on the light switch, right? The light, when you turn it on, is immediately shared with all that's in the home. Equally important, even those on the outside looking in can see the difference that your light is making. This is the description of the individual reflections of Christ that we as Christians are to have on others. If we are Christ-like, we are to radiate Jesus. That could have been the whole sermon, couldn't it? Earlier in the Epiphany season, we talked about the importance of living out our Christian witness in our homes, and we talked about if we are to draw those that we love best to Christ, if we are to share our with our children and our spouses the spiritual treasure that we have in Jesus, then we've got to understand we have a responsibility to share the joy of being in Christ with those within our own home. We must live out before them so wonderful. I'm going to stop right there. I remember, this is a true story. I remember I was preaching a sermon one Sunday. We got to the altar call, and this little boy come walking down the aisle. He couldn't have been 6 years old. And of course, my chest puffs up, and I think I've really done something, you know. And I ask him, I said, what did I say that made you want to come to the altar this morning? He said, oh, no, Pastor, nothing you said. It was my mama. He said, I want the joy that she lives out every day. That's what we're talking about, radiating Christ. When we radiate the joy of Christ, others are going to want some of it. Done forgot the sermon anyway. Give you another one. My dad used to talk all the time about mule-faced Christians. Remember, I've used that analogy. He said, those are the Christians that's faced so long, if it's any longer, they drag the ground. He said, you can't give that stuff away. Nobody wants that. If you're reflecting a miserable Jesus, no wonder people are rejecting it. Who wants a miserable Jesus? Come on. Am I wrong? Reality remains, I get it. Life is hard. Jobs can be stressful. Relationships can be difficult. And sometimes we let our guard down and we forget to radiate Jesus. Sometimes our families see very little evidence of the spiritual joy we claim to have. Jesus said, he said, that don't make sense. He said, it just don't make sense to light a candle if your intent is to hide it to start with. Why even bother writing it? But then on a grander scale, now I want to talk here about our collective light. I want to talk about our responsibility of coming together and being one light, one responsibility of being a church. Jesus compared his church to being a city on the hill. Collectively, as church, we are to be the light of Christ, shining out into a sin-darkened world, drawing others into the love of Jesus Christ. So I thought about that this week. I thought about, have you ever been on a long trip and it's late at night and the world is dark all around you and you're totally exhausted and you're fighting drifting off to sleep as you're driving, and just then you pop a heel and there are the lights. It might be home, it might be your vacation destination, I don't know. But it has this effect on us. Fills us with this peaceful assurance, a renewed determination that we can continue on, that we can press forward as we think to ourselves, I'm almost home. I'm almost home. I think in a similar way, that's exactly what Jesus is trying to tell the church, folks. He's saying, as a church, we gotta radiate Jesus into the world in such a way that we're always shining, always pointing others to Christ, always lifting spirits, always encouraging others, always helping people come to the realization that as we journey toward the light, we journey out of the darkness, and we're almost home. And we're almost home. For these reasons, Jesus said, you are the light into the world. And as we accept this responsibility, then as Christians, we need to realize that we have no source, we have no ability to illuminate that light for others to see. Jesus is that source. Previously, I tried to use the analogy of the moon reflecting the brilliance of the sun, but every analogy only goes so far. See, the truth is, as Christians, Jesus wants to illuminate us from within. When Jesus comes into our life, it is a literal effect. When Jesus fills our soul, when he dwells into our heart, he illuminates us from the inside, shining out for all to see. And you say, wait a minute, preacher, how's that possible? I mean, really, come on. I've seen people who you could see their light shining through. You just walk up to them and you immediately know they're in love with Jesus. The Holy Spirit's in them. Their light is shining. And then there's others who they may claim to be a Christian, but where's the light? And then there's others where you see sparks occasionally, and then sometimes there's no glow. And you say, how is that, can that be? And the only answer I have for you is, if I have a lamp and it's not shining, the first thing I do is check to see if it's plugged in. So if you're not growing, if you're not glowing in Christ, maybe this morning it's time to check your connection. Finally, as Christians, we've got to get beyond trying to fool ourselves and thinking somehow we can turn on and off God's divine light, kind of like we do the flashlight on our cell phones. Hey Siri, turn flashlight on. Hey Siri, turn flashlight off. I want to say this morning, as Christians, they don't work. We can't live in the darkness of the world all week long, just as long as we come back to Jesus by Sunday. True Christians will never try to hide or cover the light of our witness. True Christians cannot and will not try to pick and choose those who may or may not be worthy recipients of their divine light. Every follower of Christ should allow the light of heavenly knowledge and the warmth of divine love to shine through us, so that all we come in contact with is affected. When the light of Christ fully dwells in our heart, it will extend its influence to every thought we think, to every word we speak. When the light of Christ dwells in our hearts, it will affect our every action. It will direct how we respond in every circumstance. As Christians, the charge is simple. Walk in the light. Why? So we can see, right? But you know the part we miss? So we can be seen. Let your light shine so bright that others will see Jesus and desire that same light of Jesus in their own life. You know, I think maybe the Apostle Paul summarized this entire sermon best when he wrote, "For once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of the light." So how you doing? As Lisa comes back, as Jane comes back, how you doing? You know, as we prepare for our invitation, the question first and foremost, are you walking in the light? Has the salt lost his, her savor? Are you plugged in? They're getting plugged in Asbury. They're getting plugged in. And if you don't want to miss it, you're going to get plugged in too. This morning, as we prepare to close, whatever the need in your heart, is this the day you give your life to Jesus? Is this the day that you say, I'm tired of walking in darkness? I want to get plugged in again. Whatever the need in your heart, as we stand, as we sing, will you come?
Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. Oh, Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me.
Clear, all minds clear. Remember, committee team meetings immediately following worship. We'll be meeting in the Sunday school wing. If you don't know which door, just head that away and we'll point you where you're going, okay? We want to encourage everyone who wants to share in the work of the Lord, be faithful in this time. All hearts clear? You are the salt of the earth. Make a difference. As you stand for Jesus, offer his love, offer his presence, live out his word. You are the light unto the world. Show the way so that others will follow, and they too will have their lamp light their path. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen.